Okay, so also mentioned a little bit what are the sources of the electromagnetic disturbances. So there are many, many sources. We have natural sources like cosmic radiation, electrostatic discharges from lightning strikes, whatever. They are there, they were there, and they will be there. But more and more we have the so-called self-made sources. Yeah, and there the humanity is guilty because we are generating more and more electromagnetic emissions all over different frequency ranges. And we are producing more and more electronic components and electronic systems. So it's pretty obvious that the interaction and the coexistence of all these systems might be a big challenge in the future. So what kind of interferences can we generate? Environmental interferences by radio station, TV station, GSM, UMTS, Wi-Fi, or whatever signals we are using. There can be application-specific interferences generated within the application, as I mentioned, within the vehicle, when we are turning on the windscreen wipers, turning on the front light, or whatever. We always have changes of currents and voltages due to the switching activity, and they can also interfere with the normal operation of the functionality in control modules of a car. And there are also IC-specific sources for electromagnetic emission, like in mixed signal designs, we will later see. The digital design is producing the emission. The analog design that is also inside of the IC is very susceptible. They are all placed on the same silicon. They are connected by the same substrate. So it's pretty obvious that noise from the digital part will travel into the analog part. So also within the IC, we are generating emissions due to ground bouncing, substrate noise, and directly coupling of structures within the chip. Yeah, so in the same way as for the emission, usually it's not the case that there is an electromagnetic wave hitting the IC package and then generating whatever interference within the IC. Why? Because the IC is not acting as a very good receiving antenna. But if the IC is used in a printed circuit board, then we have cables, we have printed circuit board traces. They are the receiving antennas. And there can be plenty of different sources, as I mentioned, and then the antennas catching up this RF energy, for example, and conducting this RF energy into the printed circuit board and then finally into the pins of the IC. So it's mainly conducted disturbances that we have to deal with. Yeah, how can they couple into the IC? The same way as for the emission, magnetic coupling, inductive coupling, or capacitive coupling, or magnetic, inductive, capacitive, electric field coupling. Yeah. Okay, by a DI over the D via the magnetic field, or by a DU over the D via the coupling capacitor. Okay, what are the victims inside of the IC that can react to this kind of interference? So it's mainly the analog parts, pretty obvious. And they're very often operational amplifiers, band gaps, analog digital and digital to analog converters. And then the digital part, you need quite a lot of RF energy to change the state of a memory or to change the state of a transistor. But you do not need that much energy to change the output signal of an operational amplifier. And very often we are generating so-called EMI-induced DC offset. So there is a DC signal additionally caused by the RF energy when RF energy hits the operational amplifier's inputs or power supplies. And this is a very big problem, and there are quite a lot of papers on the topic how to design operational amplifiers in the right way, how to design band gaps, and now more papers are coming in the direction how to design analog to digital converters or digital to analog converters. So there is still quite a lot of work to do in order to make proper designs and find design guidelines and avoid EMC problems on the chip level.